Hey everybody, we're back. It's me, Dan Warren, here with my good friend.
Hello everybody, I'm Dave Raposa.
And tonight we're going to be continuing our adventure through Final Fantasy VI.
World of Final Fantasy VI.
Yes.
What's the world called?
This is the world of balance, because we haven't yet disrupted the ebb and flow of the three statues to create the world of ruin. But maybe we'll get there soon.
I like that.
Yeah.
So, sorry for being so late, everybody. But we're here. We made it. Team Cream. You're beautiful, everyone. We're back. And we're gonna, you know, like we always say, keep it rigged.
It's true. So, lots of stuff's happened since we last talked to everybody. We're having a good time. Pretty much all the Steve Lichtman stuff's gone out. If you got a lunchbox, it's either there already or it's on the way. If you get a top tier lunchbox, those should be there today or tomorrow. Got 2 days on all those. I've got about 20 replacement books, most of which are international because customs lost some, going out. And then once that's done and everyone's book has a tracking code, we'll put out the audiobook probably later this week, maybe early next week. Basically, just whenever the book shipping is done.
Yeah, sorry about the delay on all that. We just, you know.
Yeah, it's just another.
We don't want anybody to get it and listen to it and not have read the book, you know?
Yeah, basically, that's the whole idea, is that we want everyone to at least know that their book is on the way before they get that. Because, again, it's just the two of us doing it. And I know, because of how things work, once I send the codes out for the audiobook of the 1,000 people that got one, there's going to be at least 50 to 100 people that, you know, need fixes or the codes don't work, or
a good amount of back and forth.
Yeah. So, because it's just the two of us. Got to full-time the books and then put out the audiobooks and full-time that, and then everything should be wrapped up. So, I mean, it should be this week. I don't really see anything else going wrong. I mean, everything that can happen kind of has happened at this point.
Yeah, nothing else.
Yeah.
I mean, aside from just, like, one of us dying or something.
I mean, don't sell that short. That's very possible.
I know.
I've been joking about how you'd actually make more money on book two if I died. Oh, I should probably go ahead and do that.
We'd get on all of the websites. We'd get on BuzzFeed and stuff.
Especially if you put me in it as like a ghost character.
Yeah.
We should get on that.
What, are you dying?
Yeah, we should figure that out.
Yeah, we should figure
that out. What's the most dramatic way for me to die so that you make the most amount of money on book two? What's the best internet way for me to die?
Internet way?
Or yeah, just like what's gonna make the sales go up the most on the internet as like a viral post that I did?
I guess if you were like cave diving or something and you just didn't open your chute.
I would see that. I disagree.
Because then you'd be in a dungeon.
I mean, that is true, yeah. I was thinking maybe like I die in a graveyard somehow. No?
Die in a graveyard?
Yeah, I'm thinking something skeleton, undead related, something. Anything?
You just masturbate the life out of your body?
That's a lot. I'd need to get someone to help. After like 3 or 4, I'd be tapped.
Andrew Glassman just subscribed.
What? Andrew Glassman?
You team creaming us?
Oh my god, thank you so much, Andrew Glassman.
Thank you.
I feel like I spoke to Andrew Glassman just the other day, I believe. Let me double check this.
Yeah, Andrew, didn't you make the chopsticks?
I believe he did.
Steve chopsticks?
Yes.
Like the Cheetos?
I think maybe. Hold on, the game's going to go silent for just a moment.
Thank you for that.
I believe. Game is silent for just a moment. I believe.
Made me laugh.
Yeah, that was great. I love when people take stuff from the stream and find things to do with it.
Mono Art says that Amazon ships you to China and the boat sinks.
Oh, that's a really good idea, actually. Yeah.
Amazon ships Dan.
No. Facility. I've got it. I've got the perfect way for this to go. You have my wake, and you put me in my protective box, the coffin. And then Amazon removes my protective box and dings and dents my body. So it's unshippable. How about that?
Yeah, well, we had to cut it open.
We had to cut open Dan's protective box to see what was inside. Yes, that's what I thought. Okay, so I'll put a link in the chat. I wanted to make sure I got the URL right before I promoted it. Andrew Glassman is doing a Patreon for their comic. And yeah, you can check it out. The Adventures of Jesus and Frankenstein.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Jesus and Frankenstein, Patreon.
Godspeed.
Support. Hashtag Team Cream.
Team Cream.
Oh, we're here, you know. Ain't going nowhere. We might be a small group right now, but we're strong.
It's true. We're
very strong.
It's true. Yeah, I think that's how I die is I die in a foreign country and you hire Amazon to ship my coffin back.
Yeah.
And then they remove the protective box.
Serendia, or Serendis. Sorry, my eyes suck. You just finished reading Steve Lichtman and loved it. Keep up the great work. Thank you so much.
We're so glad you liked it. If you'd like to get a copy of book two, it's coming out real soon. You can go join the mailing list so you don't miss it.
We also got to give a beautiful shout out to Danica, Comic Book Girl 19.
Yeah, Comic Girl 19, you're the greatest. She's been, she reviewed the book on her, Hot Comics Plopcast thing that she does on her live show now. And, it was really nice of her. She also brought it up on the Game Over Greggy podcast, which was super nice of her.
Yeah, they were talking about suggestions of books they've been reading, things that they like. And she brought it up and I was like, what?
If anyone doesn't know Comic Book Girl 19, her YouTube channel is amazing. If you're a fan of Game of Thrones or anything X-Men related, she does these amazing long-form videos that goes into like the full history of the Game of Thrones houses and explains the universe for people that haven't read the books if they want to know. She does these huge one-hour documentaries of the X-Men franchise, like Dark Phoenix Saga, you know, the Origins things, like voice acted, animated. They're some of the best stuff to put on when you're working. If like, you know, you're doing art or something and you want something to listen to. I listen to them all the time. Been a fan of her stuff for a really long time. So it was really cool to see the book.
It was a happy coincidence that
we
all kind of like ended up knowing each other for some weird roundabout way.
Yeah, I reached out to her saying like, I'd love to send you a copy of the book. Well, it was really strange. It's a really weird thing where the producer of her show, Tyson, used to watch the Crimson Daggers videos like 6 years ago when me and Dave were just like kind of starting to do them regularly.
Yeah.
And he used to watch those at work all the time. And then Danica met us and we didn't know who she was at New York Comic Con and bought one of Dave's Ninja Turtle prints.
Like forever ago.
Forever ago.
2009 or something.
So we had both met her and talked to her before. And then coincidentally, I reached out to be like, can I send you a copy of our book? I think you'd like it. And she was like, I already know who you guys are. We met in New York. And when you're at New York Comic Con this year, I have an extra ticket to go to a Blood Rave, which was a Marvel Comics sponsored thing where they recreate the rave from Blade in like this really crazy like warehouse rave place in like the dock section in New York. And so I went to that with her. And then we just stayed up all night talking about everything. And she's the greatest. Your channel's great. I would recommend highly anyone working who needs something to listen to, go listen to her X-Men documentaries and her Game of Thrones stuff. It's really, really well done.
Yeah, but super nice of her to, you know, give us a shout out like that. You know,
yeah.
She doesn't, you know, we're not by any means anything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we're not popular people.
No.
In that kind of world, so it's nice of her to like, you know, push us out there into the comics universe.
Yeah, she's great. And yeah, I don't know, plus if you now that we've done an audiobook and done tons of dumb voices for like 6 hours, it's a really long thing going back and re-listening to her like X-Men documentaries where her and Tyson pretty much do the voices for all the X-Men. I have like a whole new respect for that. Just like, I'm going to do the dumbest voice I possibly can and just put it out there and hope people like it.
And if you guys haven't seen Owlboy, You got to go and check it out.
Yeah.
Adrian. Beautiful Adrian. Team Cream. Adrian Bear.
We've been watching Owlboy for what, like 3 years now? We were like...
For years.
We were watching videos of that in your underground apartment in Boston forever ago.
Yeah.
Like, we've been on that project for a long time.
If you see Adrian in the chat right now, he works on Owlboy. And the embargo just got lifted, and everybody who got a review copy of the game or whatever else is able to post videos and things. So keep an eye out for that.
Hey, by the way,
check out all the stuff that's coming out about Owlboy.
Congratulations on finishing it. That's amazing. Seriously. It's a huge milestone. The game was beautiful, 3 years ago. I can't even imagine how good it's going to look now.
Yeah, like the thing that sucks is, super nice of you to reach out and, offer up codes and stuff. We both work on a Mac. I have a PC laptop. I have a PC laptop, so I'm going to download it onto that and play it.
Because I've
literally been waiting for Owlboy to come out for years.
I'm going to find a way to hack my Android phone and play it on my Android phone. I will find a way. Or I'll go to my brother's office and I'll download it onto his computer. I will find a way to play it because, oh man, have I been waiting for that.
And drop it in the chat.
Yeah, the game's great. Everybody go check it out and definitely support it. It's a beautiful game. Lots of work went into it. It's just another really cool thing that, we're in this cool time now where people can do cool stuff.
Okay, so we got some nice comments in the chat. We also have a question here. It's asked if we've seen, Jack Bong wants to know if we've seen Kung Fury.
Yeah, it took me a minute to remember what Kung Fury was. Yes, I've seen Kung Fury.
Yeah, we've seen it. We're not huge fans of it, mostly because to us, it's kind of a complicated thing. I'll just sum it up really quickly.
I'm going to say this German word wrong. It's
what?
Schadenfreude. There you go. I butchered that.
I shouldn't have even said it.
I know. The funny thing for us, because we grew up watching those movies and renting them from our local movie place all the time, like old Canon Films movies and stuff. Those movies weren't self-aware funny or like ironic funny. It was the comedy came from watching someone's dream of making a movie completely fail.
Yeah.
And like that really, you committed that to film and released it. Like, whoa. Like, I'll watch Invasion USA any day of the week or Death Wish 3 or any of those because they're so ridiculous.
So good.
So when you see someone try to emulate that, I can't speak for everybody. The joke for us was that someone tried to do something and it was so stupid and funny. So you can't replicate a mistake because you're doing it intentionally. It's like one of the few things you can never replicate is a mistake.
Well, what's a good example of a successful version of that, of trying to ape that feel, is like Tim and Eric when they hire like actors who don't know that they're not good actors
because
they're ironic, like
they don't know
old
that the
commercials and stuff.
Yeah, because they don't know that the joke is on them.
Yeah, and that's like a real way, like they actually managed to recreate that feeling, but like with the ironic kind of action 80s thing, like. I don't know. I've had so many people reach out to us and say, this is, is this like Skull and Shark kind of thing? And no, we're not going to do that.
We fucked up. Owlboy's not out yet. It's 95% and they're bug testing.
No, I know that. I know it's not out.
I said it was
just
out.
Just saying. Oh, you said it was
out. I didn't say it was out. I said congratulations on finishing it, which you pretty much have.
Yeah.
You're bug testing. You made it. You did it.
But, to us, that stuff is, that stuff is genuinely cool.
Yeah.
So I've never felt like, I don't know, not that I'm like offended when people do ironic stuff. I just don't think it's funny. Not like, it's not like hilarious to me. That's not why I like that stuff.
Waffle Stacks just subscribed. Waffle Stacks. Thank you.
Welcome to Team Cream.
You know what goes good in a waffle recipe is a little bit of cream.
It does go good.
Some vanilla, a little bit of cream.
Some ice cream.
Some cinnamon. Ooh, ice cream on waffles. There you go.
Yeah. Okay, so Dinosaur says, hey guys, Steve. Hey guys, I finally got my book and I'm signing up for the second mailing list right now. I've been working a lot on my drawing and painting and really starting to do my own thing, not giving up and working hard. Feels good. Well, good for you, man.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's it. You just have to power through. I hear this thing a lot where people just start talking about the thing that they're going to do, the thing that they want to do, the whatever that they're going to work hard and accomplish something. And it's like, yeah, just make that stuff happen.
Right.
Deal with the punches while they're coming at you. It's like, because you can't wait for this. You can't wait for it to work out. It's like,
right.
It was pain for us to do the first book, and it's pain for us to do the second book. And it is just constant pain, but it's pain and pleasure intertwined, really.
Yes, that is a Hellraiser reference.
So, I mean, it's good. It feels good, and it's bad at the same time, but it's more good than bad.
I get that a lot of people like Kung Fury before we just pass up on that.
Yeah.
It's totally cool. It's just not our thing. There's stuff in Kung Fury I thought was funny, but like, I don't know. The whole like ninjas, Hitler, dinosaur thing, like that was stuff that people were joking about when we were like in high school in like 2003. Well,
it's the same thing as when, you know, bears was the thing that was funny, or mustaches were the thing that was funny.
Exactly. It's just that stuff, I don't know if that's like just because where we grew up, but that was all stuff that was funny like almost 20 years ago. Like, it's so like dated for some reason. So like, I don't know. When I see like a dinosaur with Hitler with ninjas and stuff, it's like, I've that's done, dude.
In the most hipstery way possible, we were definitely joking about that stuff years ago.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, 100%. That came in. Well, because we found realultimatepower.com.
Yeah, realultimatepower.com. Let's just say
when we were like 14
on the ground floor. Realultimatepower.com was the ground floor of all of that.
Yeah, like we both knew about that before we even knew each other. And then we like shared our love
so
for it.
That I kicked my mom in the face.
Yeah, exactly. That was like back when it was that site and Maddox's website where like people just kind of all found them organically for some reason.
And I also gotta put a plug out for that, because that dude didn't stop. The Real Ultimate Power guy didn't stop. I read his book on ghosts and aliens.
I forgot that existed.
It's legitimately good.
It's so good.
Go to Amazon and, maybe not. Go to Real Ultimate Power, and I forget where the link is to his books. I guess I could just find it for you and post it in the chat.
Yes.
But, It's pretty good. It's just stupid, you know. It's just like absurd stuff. Real Ultimate Power book. Mm-hmm. All right, I'm gonna get this link to the because you can do the look inside feature on Amazon, and you can read a ton of the book. And not a lot of people have bought it. So,
by the way,
check it out right there.
If anyone listening isn't familiar with Kung Fury or the Canon Films thing we mentioned and doesn't know what we're talking about, I highly, highly recommend going and finding a documentary that came out this year called Electric Boogaloo, The History of Canon Films.
Oh, it's great.
The greatest crash course in what we're talking about. Canon Films was an exploitation movie company that started in the late 70s, early 80s, and they put out, you know, not to like make it meaningful, but they put out movies that literally changed it. Like, none of us would be doing what we're doing right now if Canon Films didn't exist, because as bad as the movies were, they greenlit stuff that influenced everything. Like, the ninjas were not a thing until Canon Films came around. Like, none of that stuff ever would have made it. Like, RoboCop probably never would have got made if Canon Films wasn't around.
Not in the same pulpy way that
no,
they did it.
No, they made pulp because they made huge amounts of money. Like, It's like, go watch that documentary, Electric Boogaloo, because just the stories, the actual things that happened with them is so crazy. But, yeah.
Really good. YOLO Swag Walker asks, what do you think of Stranger Things? We talked about that last stream.
Yeah, basically, we both loved everything except the monster.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, it's very derivative of a ton of different things, so I don't know what they're going to do for season two.
I don't either. I guess
be more derivative.
Yeah, they're gonna have to choose other things that exist in the stuff that they already took from and find, you know, new ways to do it.
Right.
Like, I can already think of a few books they're probably gonna pull from, but Yeah, I don't know. We liked everything about it except how dumb the monster was, because they chose to make it really bad CG.
Right.
And nothing breaks your immersion faster when everything is real than bad CG.
Right. Jack Bong asks, is there a P.O. box that we can mail you a thank you letter or something nice to show our appreciation for your hard work?
There's an email address.
Yeah, I mean, we have an email, but I mean, eventually when we're like a little bit bigger as a company, we'll definitely have to get a P.O. box.
Yeah.
For all sorts of stuff.
We need somewhere to put death threats and stuff. I
mean, we need a P.O. box so we don't get swatted, to be honest.
100%.
Because if this gets popular, somebody's going to try and do that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Which means that, I don't know, I'll have to start using a webcam for all of these streams. And every time we're live, I'm going to dress like a fly so I can become viral on the internet.
Please do it.
For getting swatted as a fly.
Wow. I'll call in the SWAT just to make that go viral.
The worst joke in the world.
I'll do that, yeah.
Man dresses like fly for months.
Fly gets swatted on, yeah, fly gets swatted on twitch.com.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Adrian still didn't get his copy of Steve. What? He said, I got my new passport today, but I was hoping it would be Steve Lichtman. I have my priorities straight.
Adrian, did you reach out to me on the Kickstarter? Because I can track that. I can find your book. I can tell you where it is. Reach out to me on the Kickstarter.
Waffle Stacks has been watching your streams on YouTube for ages. Glad I could finally catch you live. Well, thank you so much, and thanks for subscribing to us.
Yeah,
thank you. Yeah, I mean, you're beautiful. You keep us alive. You feed us that cream. It's real.
Soaking it up.
Let me see here. Andrew Glassman. Hey guys, did you ever have any hurdles to leap over while writing Steve Lichtman? Like when combining the visual elements, panel, speech, page turn, layout to the story?
So here's the fun thing. If you read the book, if you get a copy of it, you can see the hurdles that we had to go through in real time. Because the comic starts off as a really kind of like
serial.
Nothing, like just really bad sketches. Like, we just made quick comics and put them on Facebook, and it's just quick,
wasn't meant to be anything.
Quick drawings, quick colors, and then, like, you know, obviously it was designed for the internet. We didn't know that it was going to become a book, so the page layout isn't even there. There's like some blank space at the bottom of a couple in the beginning, and then it gets a little better, and then it gets a lot better by the end, and it starts to look like, you know, cells from like an animated thing towards the very end of the book.
Wait till you see book two.
Yeah, book two is like an entirely different thing. It's completely different. But yeah.
I mean, the main thing is that, like, after we finish the script and Dan goes over it and tightens it up and stuff, like, we'll just improvise it, talk through it, you know, like we've said on here before, about how we do our process of just chatting on Skype till we find something, being the characters and whatever. Format that and do a script. I print the scripts out here. I map out the scripts as they would be pages. Mm-hmm. And then I do thumbnails of those, scan those into the computer, put them in the format of the page. And then you go from there. But like, everything is done in steps. So I don't know. Like, it's not, I feel like we're preparing every step of the way. Like, we describe what's happening in the shot. Like, we say, like, in the
sequence,
or like, this character's shocked for a panel. Or
I try to, like,
whatever.
When we're talking through the scripts, I try to write down all the descriptors. So, like, there's less of a hurdle to get to or get over when it goes to drawing it and coloring it. So, if something is, like, you know, supposed to be making fun of, like, something cinematic that we've seen before, or if they're in a very specific location, like there's one in a pawn shop and we wanted specific things to be in it, or Flay's room, we describe all that and we write it like a movie script and put all that stuff in there. So, it's right there, you know. Panel three, it's this room. This stuff is on the table. The characters say this.
Yeah, I mean, it's not really like a hurdle. The hurdle for us is just time.
Yeah, pretty much. It's time and
Steve Lichtman at 388 pages.
Yeah.
Which is like the number we have right now. Like, we're still building to the Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, you know, for that much work, it takes, you have to keep to a schedule of 6 to 7 months doing like 60 pages a month.
Yeah.
Flat. Like, you have to be able to do that or you will not make a deadline. So it's like, that's the harder hurdle, is that we know the book is huge. So getting through that and just keeping a pace going for every single day for 6 months, that's the hard part. And you can't take days off. You can't do anything.
It's a lot of juggling unknowns too, because once you figure out, like, I have to do this many pages a week no matter what, that means I have to get this many pages done a day no matter what. Then if things go wrong, that you also have to figure out, like, oh no, the printer needs this thing we didn't know they needed, or oh no, Amazon did this thing we didn't know they were going to do. It's forcing yourself to fix those problems on top of what you're already committed to doing, which you can do. It's just, it gets kind of crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty insane.
The unknowns have been the biggest challenge for the first book. Like, making the book itself was a lot of work, but in terms of, like, challenge, it was the unknowns.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Arcane Chroma says, hey guys, I'm going to be selling my work at a comic convention for the first time next month, and I was wondering if you had any tips for a first timer.
Meet lots of people, talk to lots of people.
Yeah, it's less about selling what you have for work and more about, like, I mean, you want to do that, but of course,
yeah,
you want to meet people too. Like, it's one of the only opportunities you'll have in the year. If you do a bunch of them, then you'll want to.
Well, there's very little.
Continually do that, but
there's very little you can do to push the sales of your work once you're at the con. People will kind of look at the work, and if they like it, they'll buy it, and if they don't, they probably won't. Like, yes, you can add things onto your booth to make it more visible, to show off things better, and that will help. But it's basically, do you have something people want? And are they able to see it so they know that they want it? Those are basically the two things you control. And then, that's basically kind of it. Because you can't, like, put a ticker in front of your booth and shout at people or you'll get kicked out. You just kind of have to let it happen. But it's one of the few places you can go where lots of other people that are very similar to you are also there. And if you can make connections and, talk to people and cross-promote and stuff like that, then you're setting yourself up to get way more fans down the line who will buy your work at other cons or online or hire you to do stuff because they know about you through this other person. And that's really, really helpful.
Yeah, I mean, the thing I would say just as a basics of, like, selling your stuff is don't lay it flat on the table. Get some stands. Make sure they're pointed out towards where people are walking. Don't point them straight out. Point them at angles. So they're, facing people where they're walking. And maybe if you have larger prints, like, hang them from the front if it's not like a high traffic con. If it is a high traffic con and they allow you to make, like, bigger displays where you can hang stuff, or you do have a wall or something, you want to know all that stuff in advance. And you want to bring, sample prints that you're going to want to clip up or something. And yeah, I mean, it's more about just, if you have a stack of prints, it's hard to sell to a crowd if people can't see what's in the stack ahead of time.
Right.
Because you don't want people just sifting through the pile. You want to have them up on display of, like, this is what I have. This is my stock. And you want to put the price on it. Like, get a, you can go to any kind of craft store. Like, there's, I don't know where you're located, but if you go to, like, a Staples or something like that, Office Depot, you can get these little stickers that are like, the post-it notes that are designed to look like explosion or something, for like something you can write a price tag on, and you just stick it to the print, whatever your show prints are. And that way you don't have to explain things over and over to people. Also, if you have an option, I don't know the best program for this, but you want to get a card reader if people don't have cash and accept card there, unless you're trying to take money under the table, which is a smart thing to do.
Yeah,
because then you don't have to report it on your taxes necessarily.
Oh boy,
here we go. You do, but I'm saying that
asterisk,
any way that you can get around that, go for it. And yeah, so card reader's a good one for people who don't, you know, have a lot of money, because at some cons, sometimes the ATMs will like die or something like that. Like that's happened at New York Comic Con before.
Mm-hmm.
Like the ATM closest to my table died.
And oh, that happens all the time at cons.
Didn't have anything.
Yeah, because 10,000 people are trying to use 6 ATMs.
Yeah, so that's just some kind of more like, you know, obvious, like this is what you do when you're there kind of thing.
Probably the best advice for selling at a con, I mean, as simple as it is to go on modelmayhem.com and try to undercut a girl's rates to dress up like Psylocke and flirt with people to buy your prints. Really, really dehumanize her. Make her wear the skimpiest possible outfit and tell her flat out, if you don't bring 25% boost to my traffic at my table, I'm not giving you shit. You work for me.
Yeah, I mean, really what you ought to do is definitely hire some beautiful people to run your booth. I'm not sure if that's a good idea.
They made that, didn't they make that a thing you can't do anymore because it was getting so ridiculous where they're like, yeah, booth babes aren't a thing anymore. They're out. Like, I'm pretty sure New York.
Universally, I don't think.
I think New York said.
Game places,
right. Mostly.
I don't know. But I'm not sure if that's a really good idea. Like, I think it is
terrible
on where you're at.
It's a terrible idea.
No, but I'm saying, like, I think that is a good idea in some circumstances. Like, not exactly what you said, but to hire
pretty people to work your booth. I mean, this is the thing, is that The reason they got rid of it is 50% because it was really sexist and 50% because it 100% works.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the thing that sucks about it, is like, yeah, people were getting an unfair advantage because they were basically hiring girls to wear nothing and flirt with people as they walked by. Like, do you remember when we were selling the Ninja Turtles stuff at Comic-Con and that guy walked by with a girl dressed like, was it Felicia?
Hold on, we gotta pause for a second.
Sure.
Value contrast, just subscribe.
Oh! Value contrast, thank you so much.
Full of the white stuff.
Oh man, I'm glad I'm not lactose intolerant because I got so much cream in me right now.
You got cream, bro. Oof. Thank you so much. You keep us living.
Thank you.
Beautiful value contrast, bringing value to the stream.
But anyways, thank you so much. Not to make fun of this guy, but I'm 100% gonna make fun of this guy. Do you remember the guy who came by the booth when we were selling the Ninja Turtle stuff in New York Comic Con? And he had a girl, I want to say dressed as Felicia from Darkstalkers, and she was on a leash. And she was very, very clearly hired by him because she wasn't talking to anybody.
I don't remember this.
And you don't remember that? Because he walked up and he went, oh, Dave Raposa, I've seen your work on blah, blah, blah. And he was like, oh my God. Like, the guy was... compared to the situation the girl was in, was the most night and day thing I've ever seen in my entire life. She wanted to die. She did not want to be there at all. And he was like, come by my booth and check out blah, 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 if you get a chance later today. Like, small talk.
Yeah.
And I was like, you have this girl on a fucking leash, dude. Get out of here. Like,
I mean, the problem is that I think that tactic only works at, like, vape.
No, because what he was doing, the reason why I brought it up, what he was doing is he left his booth to walk around with this girl on a leash. And when people would look at the girl, she'd like do a little cat thing and like wave her hand at them. And then he'd give them a card. They'd look at the girl and he'd be like, oh, come by our booth later today to check out. Like that was his in, was to trick people to look at her. It's like, oh, God. And it worked.
Yeah.
Mm. But yeah. Anyways, I wasn't serious when I gave that advice, but it does work, unfortunately.
Yeah, I definitely don't condone it.
No, I don't either, but it's like, you know.
But if you're just all about the money.
the Nazis invented scuba gear. Am I not going to go diving? I don't
exactly,
know.
Man.
I don't know.
Also, what are they just, you know, brain surgeons?
Inconvenient truths.
I did all kinds of shit. Okay. Luis Prado. I know I've talked to you before, but ask guys, did you ever have a nightmare where some accident happens, like you lost your hand or something like that? I saw what happened to James Zapata. I think it was him. Looks like he sliced a chunk of his hand.
Whoa, is James dead?
Is James? Did he die?
James, did you become Darkman?
Oh my god.
Was James fatally damaged and became a superhero? James.
Now I gotta do some Googling.
James, you okay?
Are you dead, James?
James! Shit, dude. Hope James is okay. Silk Drawing, I am playing Final Fantasy VI while me and Dave talk.
Also, no, I've never had that fear before.
I've had fears where I've had the your hand gets crushed fear, I think. Or maybe I just saw it in like a movie and remembered it or something. But yeah, I've definitely thought of that.
Yeah.
I have really, like, I guess it means something. I never looked up what it means, but I told someone about it and they were like, oh, that's a common thing. It means this. I've had the dream where, like, all your teeth fall out or, like, all your hair fall out.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's like a Stephen King thing, too. That's, like, in the Tommyknockers. That's why I hated that book so much, is he's, like, you know, the tooth fear and the hair fear is, like, a big thing.
Right.
The radiation stuff.
Yeah. So, like, you're just falling apart.
Yeah.
No, I don't have nightmares like that. I don't have any kind of, like, fears about
no
losing ability to like do anything.
You talk about that dream you had the other night.
What dream? Oh, that's not even a dream. That's scary.
I don't care.
Okay, Dan wants me to tell you guys about the dream I had the other night.
It's so stupid. Just talk.
It's just stupid.
Just talk about it.
I thought I'd tell Dan, and now he's gonna bring it up here like it's.
No, you share your stupid dreams.
All right. So here's what happened. I had a dream that there was this house with multiple rooms in it. I don't remember how I got here in the dream. This is where I woke up after this. And so in the dream, what happened was there was like a little yellow poisonous snake in the room. And you were like outside of the building and you'd step on these pads of like different people and like superheroes and stuff that you could be. And then you'd transform into that and then you'd go into the house. And you'd fight this little yellow snake. So I'm with somebody.
It's the dumbest thing ever.
I don't remember if I was with you or if I was just with somebody.
Sure.
But I was talking to them about, they looked at this one little thing on the ground, this pad, and it had this like knockoff Superman, like old, like when Superman first was around kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, oh, what one's that? And I was like, oh, that's like a ripoff Superman, you know, like ripoff cereal kind of thing. It's like he probably has like some stupid power that's, you know, like from that era. Mm-hmm. That's just kind of like, yo, he has the power of, you know, grip. And it's just like, you know, stuff that's stupid. Mm-hmm. You jump high. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to be that. That would be funny. So I stepped on it and I didn't have any powers. But it turned out that what that Superman was he was from an advertisement from an old newspaper, and the only thing he was from a car
so fucking from a, stupid.
It's from a car lots advertisement about, you know, cheap cars and something about like super deals.
Our super savings are from another world.
Yeah, so it was that ad on a newspaper, and I was so fucking mad that I had zero powers. The only thing I could do was get things like half off.
The power of negotiation.
Yeah, the power of negotiating a rate.
Oh, man. Oh, boy.
And then I woke up because I was fighting a
stupid dream.
With the power to get things half off. And I was going to die.
See? This is why you tell this story. It's so fucking dumb.
I have the worst dreams.
Oh, boy. That's so not stupid.
Even... So, the next day... The next day I woke up because the fire alarm went off. The fire alarm went off and I hadn't slept. And I thought that was it because Kim was making tea or something on the burner and it made smoke, whatever. So the burner's going, the alarm goes off. I jump out of bed and I look back and apparently my dog was sleeping on my pillow. So Elu got scared and peed all over the pillow.
This.
And, you know, got on me too and all over the bed.
Yep.
So that's how I got up the other day. It was pretty cool.
Waking up and
alarm was going. and there's piss all over me.
Bed full of pee.
Just wake up covered in pee.
Just a bed full of pee.
Awesome. So.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I don't know. Not a lot going on with me.
Thinking about how good that comic would be where the supervillain holds the president ransom for $50 million and you get him down to 25.
Yeah, how about 25? I'm just going...
Okay.
Okay, you...
I've saved the nation countless dollars, and you fly away. Oh, you can't even fly. You just walk away.
Yeah, I just leave. See you later, fellas.
Fellas.
Yeah, it was a really dumb dream.
We are at the part of the game now where the opera singer, Maria, has been threatened with kidnapping by Setzer, captain of the world's only airship. However, in a stroke of fate, Sela Cher, the military general turned returner, looks very much like Maria and can step in as a replacement, therefore so causing Setzer to kidnap the wrong woman.
Continue. Timbo the Champ says, Dave, you know Paul McCartney wrote Yesterday in a Dream? Maybe Yellow Snake Room is your yesterday?
Yellow Snake Half Room.
That's probably my yesterday.
Oop. We're going to fight an octopus. Oh, boy. What else do we want to talk about? I know we had a short list of stuff.
I mean, we talked about most of it. One thing that I learned about today, well, kind of relearned about, it's this really cool thing where I guess in New Orleans, when there's like a flood or something, because all the coffins are buried above ground, or at least, I mean, are they all?
Because
it's like the marsh.
I mean, I don't know. I'm sure some graveyards are, I'm sure the government said they have to be above a water line for this specific reason. Like right. You can only bury people on a hill.
So what's cool is that I guess they get washed out into the swamps and stuff sometimes. The coffins do in like a flood. And there's people that have to go into the swamps with like gators and stuff and retrieve all the coffins. It's like, that's so creepy. I thought that was just like, it's a really cool visual. I mean, it's dark, but like, I love that idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, yeah.
It's really like the creepiest thing.
Reading that's a, you know, a thing is pretty cool. But, yeah.
We're not watching.
I've been reading a book about Alexander Hamilton, his biography.
There you go.
It's crazy long.
Was it? It's like, I forget. 800 pages. Did you say it was by the guy that wrote the John Adams one?
No. The guy who wrote John Adams wrote the last book.
The Wright Brothers one?
Wright Brothers.
Okay, right.
Which was an awesome book.
Yeah.
Wright Brothers book, if you want to check something out, you should read that because, I mean, for anybody who wants to do something creative or, like, doesn't think they can do, like, their own thing, to read about, you know, people who actually changed the world.
Like, yeah.
In, like, one of the biggest ways
pretty,
ever.
Pretty, maybe, like, pretty crazy.
Like, it's crazy. Like, that's insane.
Until we landed on the moon, that was, like, the biggest thing.
But in that's how we got to the moon and shit. It's like, without the Wright brothers, like, nothing like that would have happened.
Yeah.
A-bombs wouldn't have happened. I mean, like, the everything. But the crazy part about that, what I was going to say, is that Orville Wright actually lived to see all that shit happening. Like, he lived to see, like, the A-bomb.
Pretty crazy.
Like, to think that you can invent the plane and live long enough to see that much progression is so crazy.
I learned something crazy today.
I didn't invent it completely, but...
I learned something I didn't know about Truman today, speaking of the A-bomb. I did not know this. Truman didn't know that the A-bomb was being built until 12 days into his presidency.
Wow.
He took office and 12 days into it, someone came up to him and said, oh, by the way, we've been building this. Here you go. Like, how crazy, like, they just, no one told him. He had no clue. And he was the first president to designate after that both presidential candidates have to get Secret Service information once they become the nominee, because he didn't want anyone to walk into a scenario again where they didn't realize what was happening. Because to just be told that suddenly and having no idea that that's happening is like, what are you even talking about? We're building this. But yeah.
Yeah, I'm still going to keep on pushing the book, Unbreakable. It's incredible. It's like one of my favorite books about the Pacific Theater, World War II. I know I've said it a bunch on here, but until you guys read it. No, it's a super good book. It's probably like one of the best books I've read, like ever.
There you go.
But the Wright Brothers book is great. They talk about, it's just so interesting to hear what people said about flight back then, like how sternly like people objected to it even happening. It's kind of shocking because they're just talking about how it's like a fantasy all the time. But I don't know. Like, the book is good because it puts you in the time period. It's not just like historical. They don't just tell you facts. You know, it's not like that. There's enough history there, enough like letters from them, enough correspondence in general that they can, you know, make a real narrative in the book. So you feel like you're there. And when you're hearing like how people talked about those kinds of things, it's amazing that they even attempted to make a plane, because you were basically like a UFO guy.
Yeah.
If you were interested in making planes,
right?
Like, you were like a conspiracy theorist, like that you thought something like that was possible was like shunned. Like, what are you, an idiot? Like, they would call the Wright brothers, like, even when they were flying, like they were doing flights and they would call them crazy. Like, while they were doing it, they were like, yeah, this is ridiculous. Of course you can't do that. And they wouldn't even go to look, because they were just like, yeah, those are a couple of crazy guys in the middle of a field. And they were like, yeah, sure, they've flown, because some people had even seen it. And everybody just called them liars. Oh, not Unbreakable, Unbroken.
Unbroken.
I don't know why I said Unbreakable.
Unbreakable.
I think Unbreakable is a movie.
Isn't that Bruce Willis?
Yeah, that's the one. That's a good movie.
Unbreakable.
But Unbroken is the book I'm talking about. Don't go read Unbreakable. Read Unbroken. It's a great movie. Great book.
We're now watching one of the greatest scenes in video game history.
Anyway, what's really cool about that, though, is that they kept on doing their thing, like, no matter what. And it's super inspiring. Like, if you want to do something, like, to see what somebody else or, you know, those brothers went through, in terms of just like against all odds making something happen that was to everybody like nearly impossible. Like, the whole idea that you could fly, like, not only were they doing it against what everybody already believed, but they were also, you know, it's like they were doing the math and stuff involved and like creating all of this shit to like make flight a thing, studying birds, watching how they flew, constructing wings around that, making like wind tunnels and like practicing wing shapes and shit and putting it through that as a test. It's like, you know, they're going against everybody and also all of these trials of doing like the hardest shit ever and figuring it out. It's just amazing. It's like nobody I know has that kind of perseverance. And when you read about that, it's like, okay, cool. Like, anything that I'm worried about doing is nothing.
When you see hundreds of other people trying to accomplish the same goal fail, because the amount of planes that just got destroyed, like, is in the hundreds.
Yeah, and not only are you doing that, but you're risking your life. It's like, you might be the only person that knows how to fly and then die. That's why they never went up, at least in the beginning. They didn't go up in planes together in case one of them died testing it, because then flight would just be gone.
Yep.
It's amazing. And one of the crazy stories in it was Theodore Roosevelt wanted to go up in the plane with them.
Of course he did.
When they were testing.
Of course he did.
Yeah, and he was like fighting for it, and they were like, no, 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 don't do it. And that same day, like while they were testing it, this other guy went up instead. And when he went up, he just crashed. Like, he just ate shit so hard that the guy, well, Orville got really messed up from it, or I think it was Wilbur, actually. Wilbur got really messed up from it, and then the other guy died.
Did we get a subscription or a donation? I saw something flash.
Christian Benson, thank you so much.
Thank you
for the donation.
Thank you.
You're beautiful.
wonderful human. Thank you so much.
Team Cream.
Appreciate it. Appreciate you.
Really appreciate that, Kristen.
I'm trying real hard. I've been watching a lot of this YouTuber H3H3. Trying really hard to stop saying appreciate you. I'm just absorbing the things he says and saying them naturally in conversations now, and it's killing me. Pop, I've said appreciate you and Papa bless so many times in real life, so many times.
God.
Where I just go, Papa bless.
Tim's Two Sneakers asks, how/what do you factor into pricing a book or a piece of artwork? Well, a book is way different than a piece of artwork.
Oh, yeah. It's basically like,
is like, you know, based on your return, how much work you put into it. So it's like, if it's a really complicated piece or whatever.
Yeah.
And like, if you're a well-known artist, then it pays more to charge a premium for the poster,
well, like,
because it creates a sense of, obviously, like, it has worth to it.
The common thread in both is it's a combination of what you think you're worth and what you think other people are willing to pay. That's the answer for both of those. But depending on what you're doing, where you're at, how high your profile is as an artist, and like the community that you're in, those two factors are all over the map, you know. If even really good comic book people don't make anywhere near as much money as someone like, you know, James Jean does for the same amount of work, just because he has a fine art audience versus a comic book audience.
Yeah, they're willing to spend more.
Yeah. So it's, you know, it all depends on what you're doing, what the audience is that you're doing that stuff for. You know, it's all part of it.
But yeah, I mean, it depends on where you're at. It's like, and who knows about you? If it's just you doing something normal, or it's not super high quality prints, that changes it. You know, how much you're investing into the thing changes it. Yeah, I mean, there's all kinds of things. And with a book, you know, pricing a book depends on what you're going for. If you're already established, then maybe you can charge a lot for a book. Or if you're like us and you want to get you know, more eyes on the book itself, then I would say it's better to get more people, you know, reading it. So you want to charge less and take a hit on the profits.
To get a bigger audience, yeah.
Yeah, to get a bigger audience so that you have some kind of established thing when you go into doing the rest of the things you want to do.
Yeah, because how you price, it's really interesting how you price your book. Because we basically on the Kickstarter, not with the PayPal, on the Kickstarter made about 200,000. And other Kickstarters make similar amounts of money, but you don't look at the backers usually. So, like, some Kickstarters make 200,000 and they have 7,000 backers, and some Kickstarters make 200,000 and they have 1,000 backers. Right. And that just shows you that it's less, the money is less of the equation than a lot of people tend to think it is. Like, if the only goal is to make money, then you can price things at like a premium if you have the audience to do it, and you'll still make pretty much the same amount of money. You'll keep more of it because there's less units being produced. If your goal is to create a platform or to create an audience, then you can, you know, you can do that too and still end up making similar amounts of cash. But yeah, it's weird to me that people look at Kickstarters and they only look at the money. Like, so many people are like, how do I make this much money on Kickstarter? And it's like, well, that's a totally, that number is meaningless because do you have 10,000 backers? Do you have 100 backers? Like, how much of that money you keep and how much of that money you spend and what that money means is totally dependent on how big of an audience you want to have. You know, if we doubled our backers and made the 200K, we'd be bankrupt. Right. You know, that's the thing no one thinks about is that number has other things that factor into it.
Yeah, it's all over the place. There's too many moving parts to that question for us to give any one answer without you being specific.
Yeah, you'd have to give us every piece of information about the audience, the work you're doing, where you're at in your career. It's too specific.
Shipping, everything. So Antoine, Luscious Maine, says, hey guys, started college and I'm making a portfolio for Spectrum. Without you guys, I wouldn't have made it this far, so thanks.
Hey. Congrats.
Happy for you.
Yeah.
Keep working up the portfolio.
Have fun at Spectrum. Talk to people.
Remember all the bullshit that we talk about.
Talk to people at Spectrum. Don't just go. Meet people. Make friends.
Yeah. Just always be reaching out and all that. But also, keep working on the portfolio. Make one for Spectrum. Make one after Spectrum. Make one after that. Just keep on making work.
Mm-hmm.
Make a schedule for yourself. Stick to it. Stonewolf67 says, what's the title of the book? Never mind. I already read all that. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Here's something we should probably mention.
Sure.
This group, Draw or Die, did a contest and did a bunch of Steve Lichtman fan art that was based on, like, 80s stuff.
Yeah.
Me and Dave aren't sure when the judging is happening for that.
Or when it'll be finished.
Yeah, we thought that it was going to be the other day, and I guess it wasn't. But thank you to everybody who participated, and we can't wait to talk about all your work if anyone's listening. I promise we'll get to it soon. We're just waiting to hear back from Ricky.
Yeah, thanks to everybody who participated in that. It was really awesome to see all the posters. We'll definitely do a stream where we just talk about all of them. You know, we're just going to show them and say something. You know, we don't want you guys to think that we're not seeing any of that work, because, you know, we definitely have been looking at the Draw or Die thread as the whole contest was going on. It's been really awesome. But yeah, thanks for that. And it'll be pretty soon. We'll have a stream up. We'll definitely do something. And you guys can hang out. We'll go over the pieces.
Mm-hmm.
That guy, 4242, asks, do you believe Anthony Jones is genuinely trying to make things right?
I think he is. I mean, why wouldn't he be? Is the other side of that question that you have to think about is, why wouldn't he be trying to make things right? And if he wasn't trying to make things right intentionally, that would suggest that he personally wants to destroy his own career, which makes no sense. I think, honestly, honest opinion, he's trying to make things right, but the costs of doing his Kickstarter over the amount of time he's ended up doing it have multiplied and multiplied to the point where he can't bear the weight of it all at once, so he has to parse it out over even more time. Having done a Kickstarter now, we understand that 6 months after you make your money, a $30,000 cost you didn't know about can suddenly show up from your printers or from your shippers, and you have to roll with that punch, and it's extremely unlikely that you're going to be prepared to take that kind of hit. I think he had every intention of finishing the book on time. It didn't happen. Then a whole bunch of costs came in he didn't know about, so he had to make more money, which meant less time working on the book. Then more costs came in, which meant even more time not making the book. Then the book got made, and he had to figure out how to ship it, had to raise more money to do that. Suddenly, it's 3 years later. It wasn't his intention to do it. He could have planned around it better, sure, but I don't think he's an evil person that wanted to screw people and doesn't care that people didn't get their stuff. I think he's genuinely doing what he can while supporting his kids to get it done. Is it enough? That's something everybody can answer on their own individually. But I do generally think, yes, he's trying to clean up the mess as best he can. But it's a big mess, and it takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
There's my rant on that.
I agree on that, but, I mean, you give somebody like that enough, like, slack.
Oh, yeah, that's why I said it's up to everyone individually whether or not they think it's worth it. Like, I was very publicly critical of his Kickstarter. Right. All my comments, any comment on there from Acceptable Comics is written by me, not Dave. Very publicly critical of what he was doing. I had, you know, I had 21 to, I think it was 23, 21 people that backed his book asking me, because I got a refund from it 2 years ago, if I could, you know, appeal to Anthony on their behalf to get their refund of the book sent to them because he was ignoring their messages. And that's when I started becoming like, okay, well, now I'm involved in this, because I don't know why people are coming to me, but apparently they are. And, you know, we had a public thing about it. We talked about it. Immediately after that, he sent out a bunch of copies of the book. People started getting them. You know, I've heard that that's slowed down a bit since then, but he's, you know, he doesn't have that many backers. He's got, what, like 800, 900 people? I think most of the people that backed the book have gotten it by now. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, in my opinion, as just standalone Dave Raposa, I just think that he could do a lot more.
Oh, yeah.
I think he wants to do the right thing. I think he genuinely wants to do the right thing. But I think that he's putting a lot of things ahead of it.
Well, that's what he's been doing the whole time. Like, the first thing you do, you know, I'm not going to get into the specifics of what he did career-wise after the book got funded. He could have gotten that book out within a year, but he chose to do other things with his career that got in the way of that. You know, people can go look that stuff up. he could have made the Kickstarter a priority, but instead he treated it like a side project. And unfortunately, when you're making a book that isn't even done yet, and then you have to publish it and ship it, it's not a side project. It's a full-time gig.
Well, it's really hard to make a book.
Yeah, very, very hard. So,
Yeah, I just think that, you know, in a situation like that, like, you got to move. I mean, as far as support from people, you know, goes, when people give you money and they give you their trust.
Sure.
I think you just move heaven and earth to make sure that it works out.
But oh,
that's me.
Yeah.
That's my opinion on just like running your business. Like, I know not everybody is going to, like, you know, lose sleep over every single thing that they do, but I guess I just project myself into that situation, and I would just lose it if I did that.
Well, this is the thing. This is the other thing to keep in mind. This isn't, you know, this is true to a degree of Anthony and other Kickstarters I've seen and other people I've seen do similar things,
right,
that you have to keep in mind.
It's not just him.
No, it's not just him. But this, what I'm about to say, is a very real thing that affects a lot of people, and I've seen it affect a lot of people. Anthony knows that no matter what happens, he will have a certain percentage of his audience that really likes his stuff still supporting him no matter what, because they're fans and they're invested in him as a human being because they've liked him for so long and promoted him and enjoy his work. You'll see comments on his Kickstarter and other Kickstarters too where they go, take as long as you want. I don't mind waiting for this project. I've waited 3 years. Another 3 isn't going to kill me. You know, I bought this book to promote you as an artist. I bought this book because I wanted to support you, because I liked your creative vision. Whether or not I get it in a timely manner doesn't mean anything to me. There's other people that say, I want it now. It's 3 years late. But the thing is that the more of an audience you have that enables you, that the artist or the other creative person, if you're making a game or whatever, knows is going to be there no matter what, the less of a stake they have in getting that thing out on time, because they know it's going to be okay. If you have a couple thousand people that don't care when the thing comes out and they just love you and they keep supporting you, that thing is going to get delayed, guaranteed, if you're that kind of person, because you're going to know that it's going to be fine. You're going to know that they don't really care. And, like, you know, it's on an individual basis. Some people stay up all night worrying that their thing's not going to hit the deadline, and they put a personal stake in, like, I need to get this out because I said it was going to come out. And other people go, hey, you know what? My audience is cool with it. That's just rolling with the punches.
It's kind of like when you're in a relationship or you have a friend or some group or whatever, and you guys are all going to the gym or you're dieting or something, and the other person says, like, they tell you it's okay to eat a cookie.
Yeah.
And you just go, okay, you ate a cookie, now I want one.
Right.
It's like, you know, if you give somebody that kind of like reassurance,
permission,
that everything's going to be okay,
permission,
then they're just going to keep doing it.
Yeah. But, you know, it's different for everyone, and that's the thing, you know. Some people... I'll compare it to Yacht Club Games, who made Shovel Knight, versus Mighty No. 9. Shovel Knight was almost a perfectly executed Kickstarter by a team that was incredibly passionate, and you could tell took an extremely high stake in the quality and execution of the game. They knew what the audience wanted, they knew what they promised the audience, and they delivered almost 100% of exactly what the vision of the game was. Some of the things they wanted to do had to become DLC that came out later for the realities of running a Kickstarter, but they're still developing that stuff and releasing it for free to make up for that delay. You can tell they really, really cared. Mighty No. 9, on the other hand, was a very similar Kickstarter that was a throwback kind of game, where, oh, we're going to make a game in the old style like NES Mega Man. They didn't care. They changed the game multiple times. What they showed on the Kickstarter completely changed versus what came out to the product in the end. They took forever to do it. The game pretty much bombed. You know, they tons of bugs, huge delays, like massive missing things they said would be in it that no longer aren't in it. Like, you can tell they just don't care. But the thing about Mighty No. 9 is that it has an audience of people that will buy anything he makes because he made Mega Man and Mega Man X. Huge amounts of people, like, you know, he's set for life. He knows that no matter what happens, he will have people paying him to make games because he made those previous games. He can rest on those laurels. Both Kickstarters got funded, both were successes, but the difference in the type of person making them is, for me, the difference. I want to support people like Yacht Club. You know, that's it's, and that's, you know, for everybody to decide on their own.
Yeah. Yep. Nobody's too big to fail.
No.
Not on a Kickstarter level, anyway.
I make the mistake of holding a lot of people to me and Dave's personal standard as a company, which I shouldn't.
Which is a problem across everything, not just Kickstarter.
Not just Kickstarter.
You get disappointed,
right?
In and people because of your own bullshit.
I understand that I shouldn't do that, and it's probably unfair and unhealthy to do that. But me as an, like, I'm speaking in terms of what other people can look at, in terms of, yeah, these are the facts. Me personally, the AJ thing, yeah, I was pissed. You can read the comments and see that I was pissed. But that came from holding someone to a standard that isn't their standard. It's our standard, and that's a dumb thing for me to do because they're not us, and they don't want to do the same things, and we're different people, and we have different goals. Like, I do that all the time. You'll see me do it on this stream a million times where I talk about something in terms of how I would have done it or what's wrong with it because they shouldn't have done this. And, you know, that's probably a bad thing to do, but it's how my brain works. I can't shut it off.
Yeah, it's the reason, like, I have that same problem, and I am deviating away right now, but my thing is, like, just in terms of relationships. Mm-hmm. Like, in the last relationship I was in, I was doing way more, and it was just one of those things where it's like you can't help sometimes but, like, hold other people to, like, your own standard, and I felt like I was working really hard and all this other stuff, and it's like, you know, it's the same thing with me and Dan doing a working relationship. It's like,
yeah,
if either one of us was doing less, you'd feel, you know,
oh yeah, you'd, like, be mad.
What's going on?
Yeah, our division of labor is pretty much right down the middle. Like, what we handle is, like, you know, we make a spreadsheet, we split it up, and, like, you know, Dave's my friend, I don't want to screw him. If he's doing a ton of stuff, I have to pick up the weight and try to balance it out, and he does the same thing for me. Like, when the whole Amazon thing got crazy, we pretty much had a 4-hour phone call and said, okay, what has to be done for book 2 to launch? You do this, I'll do this, you do this, I'll do this, you do this, I'll do this. We split it all up, and now we're just getting it done.
Yeah, like, and that's in all of life, it's like, it's hard to find people. Like, if you feel really passionate about that kind of thing, like we do, it's really hard to, like, surround yourself by people who feel the same way.
Right.
Because the cynical part of me is always like, yeah, people don't want to try and do anything.
Right.
Like, I do that stupid judgmental thing where, like, I see people who don't try, or, you know, like when we're on this stream and we're trying to talk about doing portfolios, and we always hype up, like, hard work and the amount of sacrifice you'll have to make and all that. Like, that's, you know, that's the standard that you want to, that we think, or, like, you know, our personal thing of, like, what you should do. It's not necessarily anything set in stone, but it's just our own thing.
Right.
And I like, hold everybody to that standard. And a lot of things will disappoint me because of that. Like, we'll judge things really harshly.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. It's a weird thing, but I do that even in relationships where it's like with Kim now, she works super hard, and it's kind of like the only time besides, like, me and Dan where I felt like things, oh yeah, it's like equal.
Yeah.
Like I love that. And anytime I can find somebody like that in life, those are the people I, like, gravitate towards. So
right.
Naturally when something like, what, you know, the Kickstarter stuff, it's like when you do something like that, like when you go into the same shoes as somebody else and you realize what it takes to do it,
mm-hmm.
to, like, self-publish, to create something like that. And
yeah.
You know that you can do that thing, and you know what kind of work it takes, what kind of hours. It's really easy to get, you know, judgmental and bummed out about other people. But love Shovel Knight. Love
yeah.
the people who really appreciate their fans. Love people like,
love Shovel Knight.
Comic Book Girl 19, like you're saying, like
the nicest,
always involved, always doing things.
Yeah, by the way,
being nice to us.
Another nice another quick aside on Danica, Comic Book Girl 19. She is one of the hardest working people I've ever talked to, ever. Like, she's doing her YouTube show, she's running a Patreon, she's hosting a show for Marvel. She just got a pilot picked up for a new show that she's doing with Tyson called Greater Creators. The first episode is the complete history of Jack Kirby. It studies what he did, what happened to the interest, like to the industry after him, the effect that he had on it. They're doing an episode on Mobius, Jean Girard. They're doing all kinds of stuff with that show, which is going to be great. She does these huge, you know, X-Men documentaries that she puts out for like $3 or something and then throws them on YouTube later. She does these massive Game of Thrones things. Like, she does so much stuff. Like, it's watching people do that makes me want to work harder. Like, right. I love talking to those kinds of people because they're so driven. Mm-hmm. But, yeah.
That's why I like reading books about people who do things, because it just makes me go like, oh shit, I'm nobody.
Exactly.
Like, I'm reading about Alexander Hamilton right now, and it's like reading about his life gives me like a different perspective on my own, and I'm like, okay, this kid's, you know, 17 or 14 years old, like his mom died in his bed next to him, his uncle then committed suicide in the house that he got like put into, and then the day, like a couple days after that, his grandfather died and like his dad left and he lived in the Caribbean and like had to do all this shit. It's really crazy. And I'm just like, yeah, this kid's 14 and he takes that and just gets more intense. Becomes like even a harder worker and strives to do even more with his life. And I'm just like, oh, cool. Like, I get that hype going in me. And I'm like, all right, awesome.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, people like that are amazing. Anybody who's doing something. But yeah, I don't know. Back to questions.
Yeah. We go on tangents. I'm drinking coffee. It happens.
Luis Prado. Hey. Guys, I have this client that keeps asking me for changes on a piece of artwork even before he said it was finished.
Okay.
He already said it was finished. So after he said it was finished.
Okay.
I told him that I need to charge for these changes, but he said that he already paid me. How do I tell him that I need to pay bills and my time is short without sounding rude?
There's two answers. Number one, you just say this is what it costs to do revisions because you already said the piece was done, period. And if he says, I want it for free, just say, okay, I'm not doing it. That's answer number one. Answer number two is, if this is a client you want to keep because there's going to be more work coming down the line and you want them around because you think it's going to like help your career financially, take the hit. But make sure that you lay out how you're going to take the hit. Make sure you say like, okay, I'll do two more revisions for what you just paid me. Anything after that, you're going to have to give me a revision rate, because if the revision rate wasn't in the contract that you had with the guy, or it wasn't in the agreement that you had with the guy, then, you know, you're kind of in a gray area where he thinks he's entitled to it, you think you're entitled to more money, but legally neither of you is entitled to anything. You just exchanged money for work and there's no ground rules. There's basically two ways to go about it. Just say this is what it costs, because he just said he already paid you, so you have your money. You don't need to chase him down. It's not a situation where, you know, a very common situation is he's asking for 95 revisions and he hasn't paid you yet and you're just doing the revisions to get your money and kind of chasing it. Because you're not in that scenario and he already paid you, you can just say, I'm not doing it. This is my revision rate. I'm not going to do it. If you don't want to do that, like I said a minute ago, because you want to keep the client, basically you just say, okay, well, I'll give you two more rounds of revisions. I'll make your changes, then one more set of changes after that. And then, you know, we're done. Unless you want to give me another, you know, thing and pay a revision rate. Like, I have a client that gives me, I have a Kickstarter client that gives me tons of work. Like, huge piles of work, like every 3 to 4 months. And sometimes they ask for, you know, crazy amounts of changes on something because it just isn't right. And I understand that they need it to be right because it's going to go to a sculptor. And it has to be perfect before it goes to a sculptor. And I don't charge them revisions on that because I know that it's a net gain for me to keep the client happy, because in 2 months there's going to be another, you know, 100 things that they send me to do. You know, it's better for me to just do that stuff because it's a reliable client I can always count on. If this is a one-off, then that doesn't apply. But I drank too much coffee, so I'm rambling now.
Well, Kristen Benson says, I've been studying David Poe's style and adopting his approach into my own for a couple of years, but lately I'm finding I want to get more stylized. Should I just go with it? Yeah, of course.
Yeah, don't. Always go with it.
It's like anything. Like, I copied a lot of artists. when I started. And then, I mean, even still, it's like you still look at other people's techniques. You can always learn something from somebody.
Yeah.
And then you take what you can from that and use it in your work, whatever, you know, helps you out, whatever technique you think is appropriate for your work, and then move on from there. So it's always a natural evolution.
It's that good old quote about, before you find your own voice, you sound like a lot of other people.
Yeah.
But yeah, just whatever you want to, like, that's another weird thing about that question, because we get similar ones a lot. If you want to do something, do it. That's the weird thing I never really understand, when people go, I really want to do this with my art, but I guess I shouldn't. It's like, you're supposed to be having fun.
Right.
If you want it, like, number one rule with a bullet, have fun. Like,
and you get the best work when you're having fun. When people can see that you're producing work that's enjoyable to you,
it'll
come off that way when they're looking at it. They'll go, this looks like fun.
You can tell when people hate the painting they're doing. Like, we used to talk about that all the time. You can look at work and know if someone enjoyed it or if they just did it because they felt like they have to. It makes a huge difference.
That guy, 4242, asked, when you guys were doing movie stuff, were you in the union? If not, were you ever offered to be in it? Is it some sort of secret sect?
Which union?
To work in movies.
I think you were offered it, right?
I was, when I worked on, I can't remember if it was on Ninja Turtles.
It was. I remember you telling me it was Ninja Turtles, because they could only give you so much without breaking that rule.
Yeah, so I worked on a couple things, but only when I got onto Ninja Turtles did the guys say, like, you know, I could, like, they have to make an argument for you to be in that little union. So there has to be a reason why you're the only person that can do the thing that you do. And then they can make an argument for you being a part of it. So somebody has to really go to bat for you on that.
Mm-hmm.
It's really weird. It's not something you can just find out about. It's not something that you can, like, just apply to, I don't think. Like, I don't know how it works. I mean, I know you gotta, if you really want to be a part of the union, you gotta be there and, like, be talking to people and stuff who work in the industry.
If you really want to be part of the Hollywood art thing, isn't the fastest way to hire an agent?
I mean, you can work through places that do movie stuff.
Yeah.
You can get hired that way. Like, you can work for a studio. But if you're like me and you're a freelancer, you got to be a part of the union, or otherwise they're going to, you know, you're not going to be credited as, like, a concept artist. You're going to be, like, credited as somebody who contributed in some other way, like you were a specialist or something. They got to, like, reword your status.
The flip,
so, like, you're not just a concept artist because you're not in the union.
The flip side of that is you can work for an outsourced place that does tons of stuff for movies, but you get paid less if you do that.
Yeah, I mean, if you're direct, like I am, like, I've been asked, like, oh, who's your agent? I'm like, oh, I've never had an agent. It's just, you know, perseverance, just talking to people, just trying to get out there through blogs and whatever, share my work. And then eventually somebody doing movies is like, hey, look, that guy, hire him. That was my way in. Nothing really secret about it, just kind of happenstance. Well, you know, you make your own luck. So you make a bunch of stuff that could work in a movie, and then maybe you get hired to do that thing.
Yeah, you have other blogs do the work for you by saying, they should have hired this guy to do Ninja Turtles. And then, you know, the next time they make a Ninja Turtles, they go, oh, let's look at that guy.
So, yeah, I was offered to be in the union, but then you got to pay union dues. You got to do a certain amount of work. And you, I'm not sure if this is, I might be wrong on this, but the way I figured is that you have to, like, work on stuff that, I mean, you get put into that system, and then you get, I don't know if you have to take it on. I'm not sure if that's how it works to stay in the union, but once you're in it, you know, you're part of a group, and when they want to make something for a movie, they hire out to those people on the union list. And I never really liked the idea of a union. I think that it's unfortunate that you have to hire people who might not necessarily be good for the job.
Yeah.
People who aren't, like, super interested in that thing. Like, they're not. Like, I love Ninja Turtles, old Ninja Turtles stuff. Like, I know what I would do if I were ever offered something like that. So, you know, I have a portfolio that reflects that. And that's why I was hired to work on that job. But I still wasn't a concept artist. So, like, it's funny to me how that works. You know, this thing that is so creative, movies, they don't hire the people that are necessarily super creative for the part. Like a bunch of people that I worked with, and I'm not saying like, oh, they're terrible. You know, like these people shouldn't have been doing it. It's not what I mean.
Right.
It's unfortunate that it works this way. But a bunch of people that I worked with on there were like, oh, yeah, I've never seen the Ninja Turtles cartoon. Like, I've never seen this stuff. Like, I don't, you know, like, not that they weren't doing cool stuff, but it's like, it wasn't their thing necessarily. It wasn't something that, like, they loved or even knew much about. Mm-hmm. So it is a little disappointing that that is the way that it is. And I don't know how you'd go about getting into the union. You just more or less have to work a lot and be really persistent.
Like
quality stuff.
Like anything, yeah, reach out to an artist who's in the union that you can find and ask. You know, that's usually the best way to go about it, is to get firsthand. Yeah, it really, the union thing is unfortunate for a lot of reasons. It's just like, I get why they exist. Well, actually, that's not true. I get why they exist in other fields, like factory work and stuff like that. I get why that exists, and I understand the need for a union. In Hollywood, I feel like it's just kind of an unfortunate thing. Just like, you know, I feel like we'd get better stuff if it probably didn't exist. But, you know, they have to hire the people they have to hire legally. And that means that people get complacent because they know their job is safe. And then standards drop, results drop. No one really cares. It becomes a paycheck gig. And yeah, that's not for everybody. I'm sure a good amount of people doing that thing are really passionate about it and love their job. But, you know, anything that becomes safe like that, where you can't fire me, I'm in the union, I'll sue you. We have union reps and lawyers that will destroy your company if you fire me.
Standard, or if you don't hire them.
Yeah, standards take a hit, no matter what. In every scenario where that happens, your standards take a hit.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's how it is.
Mike, 86. I didn't work through a studio. Aaron Sims, no. I just worked for myself and directly with the director and stuff. Tim's Two Sneakers. Is it a dick move to sell a series of black and white books throughout an extended period of time and later put those together into a one big book and add color and sell it?
No.
No, that's what they do all the time with trades.
That's what they do with everything.
Yeah, so that's just comics in general.
Iterative, like how many versions of fucking Garfield and Calvin and Hobbes are there? But yeah.
Yep. Kristen Benson, my last question, honest. I asked this before, so sorry for repeating. You have mentioned books which are really helpful, the War on Art, etc. Which would you start with, get first?
Which book about art is the most helpful and get first?
I think it's just like the time management stuff and all that kind of thing.
Sure. I mean, I'd get the audiobook of Getting Things Done.
Yeah, the audiobooks are good. I mean, it's easier to listen to audiobooks while you work. Well, just get audiobooks of all the stuff we've talked about.
Yeah, get Getting Things Done, because then you can leave it on while you're working and actually follow the advice.
Yeah, and the other one was Anything You Want by Derek Sivers is the audiobook that's my favorite from all those. Goobone asks, hey, have either of you guys done work for t-shirt companies? I'm going to be doing some designs for a t-shirt startup and was wondering if you guys had any advice.
Yeah, I've done some. You've done your own t-shirts. Have you done any for companies?
No, I've had my stuff licensed for shirts.
Yeah,
like
I mean,
the mountain licensed my like Venom picture.
Like anything, the biggest thing about t-shirts is understanding like the canvas shape, because no matter, you know, I talk about this a lot when I do, like, you know, lecture stuff when teaching. Like, before you put any stroke down on a canvas, it's already a shape. It's a square. You know, it's a rectangle. So every shape that you put into that, every line that you draw has to be relative to that. That's why composition exists. That's why the rule of thirds looks good. That's why the golden spiral feels nice when you see it in a composition. It's because they're all relative to the fact that you're working inside a quadrilateral. That's where all that comes from. Composition is relative to the frame you're composing in. T-shirts have, you know, is it a V-neck? Does it have a round cut out of the top? How high is your design going to go? Is it going to look silly there? You know, what's the border of it? Does it have a clean square border? Like, is it like a tarot card printed on a shirt? Or is it going to bleed out of the border? And how does that activate the space? You know, think about how shirts look on people. How big do you want the artwork to be? Where does it go to? You know, how does it look when it wrinkles? You know, just all kinds of weird little things you don't have to think about on a flat image. It's basically just like, you know, you want an exciting, cool design that looks good to wear, and you want to make sure that it's resting well on the shirt and it doesn't look awkward. You know, you don't want it to be too close to the neck. You don't want any weird tangents where things are curving the same way the neck's curving. And yeah, that's basically my best advice on that.
Yeah, I don't get any other shit to say about that, man.
Yeah.
All I can say is what I did, which is just make, I designed designs for my own shirts. And then I haven't printed, shipped them. Satan KH asks, what do you think a a VFX studio is looking for in a portfolio?
We don't work in VFX, so yeah, take this with a grain of salt.
All I can tell you is concept arty stuff, and that's just kind of the obvious of, you know, make stuff that could work for film. You know, do designs and, or I mean, do like your own take on stuff.
The most general, yeah, like the most general answer I could give is the same for an art portfolio. Make stuff that you think is cool and would be cool in a movie or a game.
Visually inform CG and stuff.
Yeah.
If that's what you're primarily looking to do. Unless you're looking to do like costume design, all that.
But yeah.
So, hey man.
What's going on?
I don't know. I gotta jump off of here.
Well, do you want to wrap up? How long have we been on here?
Almost 2 hours.
Oh yeah, let's wrap it up then.
So
wrap it up.
Yeah. I gotta get back to doing some. Gotta do more comic stuff. I gotta put the dishes away and put more dishes in the dishwasher. Mm-hmm. So there you go. Get some human things to do in the house.
Well, if anyone's wondering, after tricking the gambling rogue Setzer into kidnapping Celis in the place of Maria, the opera singer, our adventurers find themselves in the imperial city of Vector, heart of the Empire, to break into the Magitek research facility and learn what secrets they can about just what Emperor Gestal and Kefka are doing.
It's such a bummer. All of the lore stuff. So sick of it. I'm unsubscribing from this stream.
One last question. Do we have any?
No, I'm just saying. Everybody's just saying goodbye and all that.
Well.
So, yeah. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Thanks to those of you who subscribe. We really appreciate you. And those of you who have already subscribed, beautiful people.
Beautiful.
Team Cream, you're the best. We love you. It's been fun hanging out.
Yeah. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Looking forward to getting the audiobook out to you guys as soon as the books are out. And
yeah, it's just me handling everything. If you guys have questions about audiobook when it's coming out or any of the reasons why I'm delaying it, it's just me. Yeah. It's because every day I've got 3 or 4 more people contacting me saying my book never made it out of customs, and then I have to file an appeal with Amazon and call customs and try and figure out what's going on, and it's just like, it's a full-time job. Once I get all the, made sure the books are out, we'll send the audiobook out.
Yeah, and to people who are wondering about the comic and you haven't read it, you can go to stevelichman.com. The link is in the chat. Whoops. I guess all you have to do is type www.
Yeah, dude.
But the link's in the chat. At the top, you can subscribe to our newsletter, and we'll let you know when the next book is coming out this October. It's book 2. It's like almost 400 pages long, and you also have a chance to buy book 1 with it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, thanks all of you creamsters.
Thank you.
And I don't know. I hope you have a good night. I hope you're feeling good. I hope you're beautiful.
We'll see you all this weekend.
Yeah, we'll be back. We'll bring up the draw or die Steve Lichman entries.
Yeah.
We'll
take a look at
those with you all.
That'll be good. And we'll figure out just what's going on underneath the Imperial City of Vector.
Oh.
And YouTube.
Hey, YouTube.
YouTube.
Outdoor.
Good to see you, YouTube. How's it over there, YouTube? It's really hot here today. I had to shut my AC off so you wouldn't hear it the whole time. It's really it's
muggy over there.
Getting sweaty.
Cool.
Yeah.
Oh, YouTube. I don't know. I had pho last night, YouTube.
You had pho?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Do you like pho?
I love pho. We went and got it in New York, remember?
Yeah.
Super good.
Pho's great. There's a place down the street called Pho 99. If you're in Colorado, you know what I'm talking about.
Why do they always put numbers in the titles of those restaurants?
Lucky numbers, bro.
I love that. No,
I forget exactly what the reason is. Kim told me, though. I don't remember what it was. Wow. But Pho 99 is down the road. Great broth. You love it. It's super good. You know, it's just a great, you know, soup hybrid. It's got some beef in there. It's got some tendon. Tendon's great.
Nothing
if you don't
like
know that.
Nothing like some tendon.
It's awesome. So yeah, I had that. It was delicious, and slept only a couple hours last night. I mean, the night before last. So
dope.
Went to bed early. Went to bed at like 9.
Totally dope.
Woke up real early. Been working since.
Always feels good.
So, yeah, that's been my day. Comics and stuff.
There you go.
I can't wait for you guys to see the preview issues.
Oh,
that
yeah.
Put up online.
It's going to, what, like 40 page preview?
Probably 30.
Yeah. We're still trying to figure out exactly how much we want to put up.
We don't want to spoil it.
With the book one preview, that's going to be close to 100 pages of the whole run. So it's going to be a lot.
Yeah, we're going to put up extra pages from book one for the preview because the book's still 250 pages pretty much.
Book
it's a
two,
little less than that.
We're so much happier with book two than book one.
Yeah, but book two, oh boy.
Oh, we can't wait
now
to
that
show
we
you.
Know that we're going to be able to stay alive making comic books, things have changed a bit. And once you see the preview comic, I think you're going to be pretty hyped.
Yeah, me too.
Because we're real excited about it. We made it.
The jump in execution from book one to book two is still hilarious to me.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty funny.
Well, thanks, YouTube. Good seeing you. We love you. Papa bless.
Yeah. Papa bless.